So I'll go step by step. Just I picked up a few when I was preparing for the class. This is the book, as I said, More Answers from the Mother. I don't know what the edition, yeah, obviously, Third Impression 2010. So this is on page 225. A friend wants to offer 4 or 5 electric fans for the dining room. He will pay for the upkeep for a year or two. Do you accept? Yes. I've heard from his wife that he wants to put a ceiling fan in my room also. My first reaction is, no, I don't want luxuries. But it seems a greed is lurking somewhere. What's your advice? And the disciple says, I'm not asking for your sanction. The mother writes, the room is small. A fan would be good. You can take it and see if it helps. What is bad is slavery. Slavery to abstinence as well as slavery to needs. What comes, we take. But always ready to let it go if it goes. I mean, I picked up all these things because they deeply touched me. That into what personal details, she said, she knows everybody's room. She says, yes, your room is small. I know that. So you can take it, but just don't become a slave of it. One day we don't have current for 4 hours, so don't cry and panic and say, hey, this current is not there, it's too hot. So when it's not there, keep cool. When it's there, enjoy the cool. So the both ways. Now we have, as I said, another example here. The disciple informed the mother of recent difficulties in receiving visitors at the ashram gate. And you see the administrator here. The mother replies, to avoid all stories, within inverted commas, and complications, it is better to have a second man or boy at the gate between 12 and 2 to bring groups of visitors, especially when they are children, to Quadro's house where there is a big veranda which will be provided with seats for them. I have received complaints that Y is very rude. I do not know how far it is true, but you might ask him to behave properly. The reception room will be closed between 12 and 2. And the veranda cannot be crowded with families, children and luggage. I'm trying to arrange things decently and need your help. This is 1963. So you see, she had an absolute clarity of each room, each place, each thing happening. And she guides each one of them when the office should be closed, what time it should be opened. So it's not that she left the ashram to the people saying, okay, do whatever you want. You see, one is, you know, her aspect of Maheshwari, okay, she has given the guidelines. But look at these intricate details. Then there's another one, very simple one here. It says, I will just read out the letter. In mid-1964, there was a severe shortage of milk in the ashram because many cows had contracted hoof and mouth disease. To supplement the diminished milk supply, powdered milk was given with the mother's permission. But the result was vehement objection from many persons. In general, it was a time of material difficulty, with much rumor and gloomy foreboding about the ashram's future. The disciple referred to these things in his letter to the mother. Mother replies, yes, all these false and idiotic rumors have come to me after turning round the ashram. I attached no importance to them. I hope that those who are faithful and have common sense will not lose their time listening to all that. All what you say about the food business was known to me. But you will admit that there is always a way of improving one's action and make it more luminous and comprehensive. For the powdered milk, for once I see things like why. The taste is detestable and the effect on the body is still worse. I have witnessed many cases of poisoning through powdered milk and I'm not ready to risk that. When money is missing, it must be replaced by an immense effort of goodwill and organization. It is that effort that I'm asking for, a triumph over tamas and lazy indifference. I do not want anybody to give up, but I want everyone to surpass himself with love and blessings. That was regarding the food, the powdered milk and her opinion about that. And then I go to the next one. Mother, yeah, this is reflecting what Shobhanand is writing here. Mother, X tells me that Y and Z of his department are completely neglecting their work. The machine in the latter's charge is covered with dust. Younger W is teaching him all sorts of bad habits. I do not know what to do. I mean, it's so very interesting to see how the people in charge of the departments. It's not that they were always writing and seeking mother's spiritual guidance or great, psychological problems. What's interesting is this day-to-day, hour-to-hour problems in every department. So everybody must have written to mother. And you see how she has this multifaceted administrative capacities, that to each one she's giving an answer according to his need, his growth, and the department and the ashram in total. So when there is this neglect of work, he says the machines in the latter's charge is covered with dust. Mother says, the bad service comes always when the proper consciousness is lacking at the head. You see the word? Lacking at the head. So that's why the department heads had to be very careful. They had to be very conscious. Because it's not just, the department head is not the person who has the power. You see, we mistake today that I'm in charge of so-and-so department, I'm in charge of this committee, I'm in charge of that committee. What brings you is the ego. But here, look at her. That when the proper consciousness is lacking. So if you have been put in charge of a department, it becomes your responsibility to rise in consciousness. So she is squarely putting the blame on the head. It says lacking at the head. A clear and precise vision of what is to be done and a steady, calm and firm will to have it done are the essential conditions for an organization to be run properly. I'm in the process of writing an article on mother's management. And you see her guidelines, that there should be a firm vision, a steady, calm and firm will to have it done are very important. So, and she says, and as a general rule, never ask from others the virtues you do not possess yourself. I have a strong feeling that in that department, the supervision is not what it ought to be. People really ask, what did the mother do? How did she guide us? You see, all these things are on a day-to-day level. This is proper sadhana. One is the question of consciousness. And the other one is remarkable. As a general rule, never ask from others the virtues you do not possess yourself. So if a virtue is to be done, you have to have it yourself. Others you don't expect. So that's again, I mean, one of them where we see her work. And then I go to something on the more on the psychological level. There are two letters here. I'd like to read out two of them, both of them. Sweet mother, I worked with X up to the 23rd, but my giddiness became so bad that I dared not go out. My blood pressure has gone down to 96-70, according to Dr. Y, who came this morning. Sweet mother, if it is possible, pull me out of this darkness and suffering. If it's not possible, please let me feel your living presence within me, and I shall endure any suffering. Mother, as soon as you start feeling bad, you should try to repeat this. Lord, give me the strength to think only of you. With my blessings, love and blessings. Another letter, we don't have the letter, but mother's answer. My dear child, there's nothing to forgive. You have done nothing wrong. When I received your letter, your last letter, I transmitted your prayer to the Supreme Lord so that the truth may manifest without obstruction. Be peaceful and trusting. What is happening is the best for your psychic being. And in the inner calm, you will feel that the Lord is with you to bring you successfully through every ordeal. As for the work, I will see what can be arranged so that you can remain occupied without straining your body more than it can bear. My blessings are with you. And another one mixed on the physical and psychological level. My dear child, I am not at all displeased with you. On the contrary, I find you full of courage and endurance. But my work is so absorbing that often I have no time even to write a line. I mean, this may be a bit of a surprise, but see what she says. It is better to take sleeping pills than to spend sleepless nights and suffer as a result. Never imagine that I am dissatisfied with you. My force, my love, and my blessings are always with you, so that you may be peaceful, calm, and contented. All these letters that I read out till now were from one particular ashramite, and this is another person writing. See the, what we are saying about Maa Saraswati, the meticulousness and the concentration on minute things. Here is one example. Sadhak writes, I ask prosperity. I think all of you know what prosperity means. On the first of every month, all the ashramites receive their necessities, their monthly requirements about oil and toothpaste and all of this. That's called the prosperity. I asked prosperity for 2 hardcover notebooks, but they weren't given. Did you refuse them? See, we may be thinking, you know, people have really wasted their mother's time. But it's not the wasting. It's, you know, this is how, otherwise it's not one of those yogis saying you attain your nirvana, meditate on the bliss and meditate on Brahman. But you see, she took each one holding the person's hand along the way he or she wanted or would grow. She says, that's what is incredible about the mother. So the person says, did you refuse them, even just 2 notebooks? Mother, no. I didn't refuse anything. They must have run out of notebooks, and new ones will have to be made. And friends, again, remember, all these the mother has written is not oral. Each of these letters she has written down. So see the immense patience, you know, never getting perturbed. And all of this from a kind of a social individual point will say, what terrible details, you know, why did the mother bother herself? But this is not that guru mother, she is the divine who is really leading each one. So she wrote down each one of these answers with so much patience. She says, they must have run out of notebooks and new ones will have to be made. But to tell the truth, you use a fantastic number of notebooks. I am sure that you have a large number of them in which only a few pages are written on, and they could well be used for something else. It is never good to waste things. Too many people in the world do not have what they need. I mean, extraordinary. You see the personal love and touch. And practical, very practical. You see, we were made it as a kind of a habit. Okay, I've got two notebooks. You write midway, you use 20 pages out of the 40, and then you get a new book. So mother catches on that. He says, you must have got some notebooks with some pages unused. Why don't you use them? The very practical, pragmatic, down-to-earth answer. And then suddenly she says to spirituality that never is never good to waste things. Too many people in the world do not have even what they need. You have got excess. So don't do that. And we have another beautiful example. Mother, Zed told me not to open my fountain pen. But as the ink wouldn't flow, I half opened it and an accident happened. Mother, you were wrong to open your pen. When you were told not to, because it is I myself who said that if anyone tampered with his pen, it would not be repaired for him. So she had her rules, I mean. I will have it repaired this time, if possible. But you must promise me never to touch it again. The compassion once again comes back. So she says, well, you have understood that, we don't have to explain that. Well, next one. The sadhak writes, I don't feel anything when I break or lose a material object. Mother, it's a fault. Not to take care of material objects one uses is a sign of unconsciousness and ignorance. One has no right to use any material object unless one takes care of it. See, it may seem very simple, but do we really do that? Taking care, she says, one has no right to use any material object unless one takes care of it. So those were her directions for the material objects. And then I'll read out one letter, which is really kind of the culmination of all this, where now we see the mother's, is not her advice, but how she looks at the world. What is her level of consciousness when she's looking at the world? Now look at this. Yeah, one very, very pragmatic answer. I think some of us apply it, but some may not. The question from the sadhak is, last night I did some grammar exercises which kept me busy up to 11:45. I didn't feel sleepy. Is that good? It's a very, very mundane, small question. Mother says, no, I don't find it good at all. I mean, waking till 11:45. You should go to bed by 10 at the latest. And I think as a very good child of the mother, I follow that rule at least, if nothing more. You know, around 10, I'm out. Sleep is a matter of habit. If you get into the habit of always going to bed at the same time, sleep will come automatically. Well, those are one of the smaller, I mean, the regular answers. But this is the last one I wanted to tell you. Oh, I'm sorry, I didn't note down the pages, but you'll find that. This is the last one, is on page 238. Mother, now one question. If you care to reply, each time that X or his people get angry with me or with the dining room, you find fault with us. Why? It is not so in other cases. Try to understand the question because the answer is extraordinary. Each time that X or his people get angry with me or with the dining room, you find fault with us. Of course, you can imagine now this person who is writing is in charge of the dining room. So he's asking, why is it that you find fault with me all the time? Why? It's not so in other cases. Mother. R is the person's name. Maybe Deepshika would guess. R, for God's sake, do not be as silly as the others. I find fault with nobody, underlining. I find fault with nobody. I never take sides. But my way of seeing is somewhat different. For my consciousness, the whole life upon earth, including the human life and all its mentality, is a mass of vibrations. Mostly vibrations of falsehood, ignorance and disorder, in which are more and more at work vibrations of truth and harmony, coming from the higher regions and pushing their way through the resistance. In this vision, the ego sense and the individual assertion and separateness become quite unreal and illusory. When some extra confusion is created in the already existing confusion, I direct upon it some special vibrations to restore as much as possible a better harmony. It is not the individuals as such that feel the blow. It is their clinging to or siding with the disharmony. To say the truth, I was confident that you would instinctively side with the truth and understand that in such cases, there is never one side against and one side wrong. I'm sorry. Never one side right and one side wrong. But all are to blame in the measure of their addition to falsehood and confusion. I mean, the line that comes immediately to my mind is Shobhinder's own from the Life Divine. All problems of existence are essentially problems of harmony. So you see, I mean, this is a finale I wanted to read out to tell you to see. I mean, it's really incredible, it's difficult to understand how her consciousness looks at this world. You see, on one side we have the detail, you know, if you should take the sleeping pill, if you should go to bed at 10 o'clock, if you should do this or not. The absolute detailed working. And on the other side you have this question of her, she says, I see only disharmony, these vibrations of disharmony. And then her constant work is to push in harmony, the vibrations of harmony. So she says, I have no sides. She doesn't take this side or that side. And all are to blame to the measure of their addition to falsehood and confusion. There's no one on this path of the truth. The moment there is disharmony, out, you have sidetracked. You have gone off the track of the harmony. So that's what recently I was talking to somebody. I said, yes, if we can bring harmony in any spot, in any institution, any place, at whatever cost, that is really the mother's victory. I said that, but when I read this, now I understand, yes, what I said has some meaning. Because to bring in harmony is mother's own work and effort and constant struggle. So this is applicable to the individual, to the institution, to the problems, to the departments, everywhere. So at whatever cost, If we can bring harmony, that's our victory. So, there's one little thing suddenly that comes to my mind. I think that Nalinida had said, it's in Bengali, but I'll tell you the meaning. You see, he split the word harmony into two halves. Har and harmony. Har means in Bengali, Here Java is to lose, give up. So he says, Har na manle ki harmony hoy. He said, when there is a kind of a problem, there is a quarrel, there is a discussion, there is disharmony. So he said, if one of you can accept defeat, Har is defeat. If one of you can accept defeat, then there will be a harmony. If both of you stand on your own so-called your truth, there can never be harmony. So he told one of the ashram persons who had been to him maybe, that har na manle ki harmony hoy. Can there be harmony if both the parties constantly saying, I am right? Well, so what again I am seeing is more and more the importance of harmony in a collectivity. The importance of maintaining, retaining, bringing back harmony in a small gathering. It may be a family, it may be a class, it may be anything. The moment there is a collectivity, the question of harmony comes in. So when we say it's really Victoire a la Dusmer, that Victoire is really harmony. Because after reading that, my whole understanding of the situation, of the problems has really changed. That all of us take pride in saying we are doing the mother's work. But this letter has really opened up my vision, my understanding. The mother's work is nothing but to maintain, to retain, to bring in harmony. And harmony is never done once for all. Harmony at different levels. You bring in a certain kind of harmony now, and again it disperses, new elements come, there's a new disharmony. So almost I see, it may be in your own individual life of a husband, wife, individual life of your family, individual life of teacher, students, relations, community, ashrams, Auroville. So it's easy to understand, but yes, I'm also aware how difficult it is to bring in this harmony. But Nalinida gives it a wonderful answer. That har or the defeat is not the defeat, okay, I say, oh, I give up, you are right. It's not the question of saying, okay, you are right, I'm wrong. But the har is the defeat of the ego. That if you can withdraw your ego, then harmony has better chance to establish itself. So this har is a really har namanle, you know, it's a very beautiful truth I've realized, that one has to give up the ego. And if all of you remember, some of you Aurovillians who were there in the early 70s, she had also mentioned this when there was a fire in one of the establishments at Aspiration. The fire gutted the van that were brought from France. And so when the person in charge went crying to the mother, she said, well, where there is no harmony, my force cannot work. So every time I see her emphasis on harmony, it takes a lot to bring in that harmony. It takes a lot of self-sacrifice, a lot of ego sacrifice. But again, I remember 72 or 73 April maybe. No, 73 April cannot be. 72 April, I think. Where one of the last messages in a group where there's a lot of disharmony between persons in Auroville and between ashram and Auroville and all that stuff. So she had called some important people from the ashram, from Auroville, and spoken to them. I mean, she says a lot of things, and ultimately what she said was, the age of the ego is gone. is over. So if you want to work for the new age, then you have to go beyond the ego. Because you can imagine the quarrels, you know, inside, between ashram, whatever, it's all problems of ego. So that was, at least as far as I remember, that was the last message I saw, a very long message that is there available in Mother's volumes also, you can see that, where she says, the age of the ego is over. Well, so I've given you sufficient examples to show you the working of Mahasaraswati. And of course, you know, you can keep on reading the entire book, almost all these incidents that are written here, all the letters are only to show us Mahasaraswati's way of working. So rest of the details of this paragraph are all kind of finding an echo in what I've read in this book. So in our next class, we can go directly into the paragraph again, and with a few comments perhaps we can complete this paragraph.